Airfix Battles, the introductory wargame, as the box says. This is a wargame that comes in a fairly small box for the box of a wargame, and it is an introductory wargame. What a surprise. It has the name of Airfix on the cover because it can be played with Airfix miniatures. Airfix, for those who do not know, is a maker of toy soldiers and miniatures that can be used in wargames. There are no such miniatures, no plastic miniatures in this set though. You have dice, which are made of plastic, and that's the only thing that's not made of cardboard or paper. You have paper maps, you have cardboard tokens representing soldiers in a top-down. The production values are not stellar here. The idea behind this design, though, is to give you a war game set in World War II that has a tactical feel and that is very simple, very linear, could be played by people that have not experienced war games before, or they play some other very light war games. Two players, but also playable solo if you can deal playing with cards. That I don't have a problem doing that. Some players find the card-driven war games a little too hard to play in solitaire mode. Okay, that's completely up to you. Let me show you how Airfix Battles, the introductory war game, works. The game is played on these two paper maps that you see here. They're double-sided, so you have a little more variety. Some scenarios will only take one map, some both, and of course you can use them to create your own scenarios. We have terrain tiles, not many types, just some tiles that represent the full cover for the square in which they're placed, and then some of these edges that block line of sight. Then we have military units. I mean, what would be a war game without them, right? Military units are represented by two things. You have some counters that go on the board and represent the number of men that are present in that unit. There are illustrations on the counters and different types of illustration, and you can match the type of illustration with the type of unit accurately, but that would only be for aesthetic reasons. Once a unit goes on the board, all that matters is the number of people that are in there, the position, of course, and this number here that matches the units with a card detailing the information about that unit. So, just to have a closer look at what that can do, what the unit can do, the card will tell you the number of people that are in that unit and what they have. For example, here we have 10 men, two of them are carrying Panzerfausts. Here you have the quality of the unit. The number of stars that you see here is used when you're creating your own forces. So you will have, for example, a scenario with 20 stars, and you can mix and match cards with different values to create your forces. Here also, when you destroy that unit, the card corresponding to that unit goes to the person that destroyed it, and that is worth victory points at the end of the game. Here we have a value that is used to pass a lot of different tests, to pass combat tests mainly, but also morale checks. Here we have the movement value, the number of squares that the unit can move. You may not see it, but if you look carefully, you see that the map is divided in squares, although only the corners, and a dot indicating the center of each square is represented. So there's the movement value, and then we have stats for the weapons that the unit is carrying. Each unit, when attacking, can only use one weapon, and here we have, for example, rifle and the Panzerfaust and also the grenades. What we have next to the name of the weapons is the range up to which the unit can fire, the type of ammo, and there may be simply other game effects that refer to that icon, and the number of dice that you roll when you're attacking with that unit, with that weapon. For example, when attacking with rifle, you have an attack die per man in the unit. At the beginning, when there's unit in fresh, there would be 10 dice. When attacking with the Panzerfaust, you are attacking with one die, but that's an anti-tank, so that's good because, well, they can attack tanks. The grenades, you can choose which type of attack you're using based on them, and there is no cover save when you're using grenades. Speaking of units, yes, you also have tanks that work almost the same as infantry units, simply in the way they take damage there is a difference, and we'll talk about that later. Now, so you place your units on the board, and then it is time to start playing the game by activating them, and you activate your units using these cards. Very interesting idea. Now, there are plenty of games where you spend a card on a unit to activate that unit. Colors and commands, or commands and colors, battle cry, lots of those games. Although in those games, usually you spend a card to activate an area, sometimes a single unit. Here you spend a card per unit. Now you will have a hand of cards and only a number of these cards that you can play per turn. That number is represented by the number of these icons that you have on your units. Here, for example, we have a captain and veterans. So the veterans need to be attached to a captain. And just for curiosity, that is where they currently are, four veterans and a captain. The captain has icons here indicating the number of cards that you can have in your hand, and that, so to speak, is contributing to your hand, and the number of cards that you can play in a turn, and that is contributing to. That means that you may have multiple cards that contribute cards. For example, in my forces, I had the captain and the lieutenant. Then I add all of their numbers together, and I add one. So now my hand would be of 6, 1 plus 4 plus the generic 1, and each turn I can play 4, 1 plus 2 plus 1. It's important to add the plus 1 because if all of your commanders, all of the people that can contribute cards eliminated, still you can, at least you can still have a hand of one card and play that one card each turn. That would be a pretty dire situation, but the possibility exists. So you have these cards, and now you know how many you have. You will have your hand of cards. Some cards have a red background. Those are interrupt, so you can play them during your opponent's turn. And the other ones, the green ones, are the ones that you play during your turn. Now, what I really like is the flexibility that you have to use these cards. Yes, you play a card on a unit to activate that unit, but the really cool thing is that you can play a unit for its front effect or one of its front effects, and when you do so, you simply resolve the effect on the text with the unit to which you assign the card. But you can also use the card, big plot twist here, for its back. Basically, you can use it as a generic card to activate a unit to move or to fire or to reinforce one of these effects. So if all of the effects that I have in my hand are absolutely pointless, useless, do not apply to a present situation, magic, boom, I can still use the card at least to move or to fire. In many cases, moving and firing, moving or firing is just fine. It's just that you do, if you do have the effect, then being able to resolve these effects is much more powerful. So simply, when it is my turn, I play a card and I activate a unit. Suppose I activate the unit to fire, then I activate that unit to move. When you move, you can move a unit up to its full movement allowance, moving orthogonally, not diagonally. The movement cost usually is 1, with some exceptions. For example, cover is 2. There you may have some tiles that represent rough terrains, not particularly attractive, but they get the job done to indicate areas that have a higher cost to enter. So you can move or you can fire. Of course, that is pretty important option. To fire is fairly simple. You look at the card for the units that you're activating to perform fire. You choose a weapon, and that will tell you the number of dice that you will roll. You roll them, and you score a hit for each number showed on the dice, which is equal to or higher than this die here, which is sort of like the generic quality. For example, I rolled all of my dice, and say I rolled 2 5s and 2 6s, that are a total of 4 hits. Pretty good. Usually, you would simply apply those hits to the opponent, but if the opponent is in cover, so tiles that show that symbol, as it just so happens to this unit, if this unit is firing, then if the unit that you're targeting is in cover, the unit receives a save roll. So the unit will roll a die for each hit that was inflicted. They will compare the result with their own quality, with the number written in this area of their own card. And for each number rolled, which is equal to or higher than their number, they will annul, they will cancel one of the incoming hits. Once you have determined the final number of hits, you remove an appropriate number of people, of tokens representing individuals. Also, if a unit took two or more hits, the unit has to take a morale check. Morale check, you roll a die and you're trying to roll equal to or higher than, I think you guessed it, this magic number here, which is used for so many things. If you pass the morale check, nothing happens. If you don't pass it, well, things start getting bad. So this is a unit which is fully operational in the game. It's called an AOK unit in terms of morale. If the unit fails a morale check, you turn it by 90 degrees so that the pin side is up, and now that unit cannot perform most tasks until it passes a morale check. That means that next time you're trying to activate it, you play a card on it, you roll a die to pass a morale check. If you fail, the card is discarded and you wasted the card in that action. If the morale check is passed, then you unpin the unit and you resolve the card effect, the action normally. A unit that fails two morale checks must retreat, so it moves back by two squares, and other than that, then it's the same as pin, so it's stuck there, but it remains on the retreat side because it takes longer this way to completely refresh the unit. A unit that is in retreat mode and fails another morale check routes and is out of the game. These are the basic concepts, really. There are several scenarios, each with different conditions, victory conditions. The general idea, however, is that you score victory points by eliminating enemy units and also usually by fulfilling conditions based on the victory conditions. Now, I mentioned briefly that tanks work the same, almost the same as these other units. They're a little harder to move because changing direction by 90 degrees costs movement points for them, which is not true for infantry. Also, when you look at their car, they have a value of armor. For example, this one has a value of 4. At the beginning of the game, you place a die on the card indicating that value there. When you are firing with anti-tanks against a tank and you score a number of hits, you need to see how many of those hits that make contact with the target actually penetrated the target. To do so, it can be you, or I prefer to give that to the target player. The target player rolls dice equal to the number of hits, and each hit, which is equal to or higher than the armor value, reduces the armor value by 1. And the player that is inflicting the hit can choose the order in which those dice are assigned. This is not a trivial point, because suppose that I'm rolling for penetration. I inflicted 3 hits on my opponent and I rolled for penetration. And those are the results that I scored. So I'm gonna use first this die, which penetrates and reduces the armor by 1. That allows me to then use that die, which reduces the armor still by 1, and that one is still not good enough. But as you can see, it may entirely happen that you are lucky and there's a sequence of results that reduces the armor of a tank to 0 with a single hit. Other times, it's, you know, single little hits, single incremental damage from turn to turn. And it's very nice because it portrays the complete unpredictability of what happens after you make contact with an anti-tank weapon. Sometimes it bounces off and nothing happens. Sometimes it goes through and the entire tank is out of commission entirely with a single hit. And these are the basics of the game. This is how Airfix Battles works. Now, come to think of it, I believe that in my main segment I forgot to tell about a combat option, which is Assault, which is simply a melee close combat. You need to be adjacent to an opponent to declare an assault. It works, guess what, like the regular rest of combat, roll dice against the opponents, etc. But the defender gets a shot at you before you attack. You do not take a morale check there, although you may take casualties. Then you attack as the attacker, and then the defender gets another shot at you. So there is this back and forth, which is particularly brutal also because no one can take advantage of cover. Usually you will use assault to take out some opponents that are in cover and that you're having trouble eliminating with range combat. So that's the main idea why you would risk your people. In general, Airfix Battles is a game that I like. I don't love it, probably, but I like it, or say I don't dislike it. It is an introductory war game that is elegant and really does what it sets out to do, which is precisely to give you a wargame experience that feels thematic enough, that feels right mechanically, that feels historical enough, but it is very elegant in its execution, that is in fact based on very few ideas, very few core mechanics, that then with small variations are applied all across the board. Board meaning in a metaphorical sense, but I guess also in a physical sense. So you have that magic target number, success number, quality number, whatever you want to call it, that is used for so many checks. The basic idea is always the same. The rulebook sometimes phrases in such a way that is not obvious. Sometimes it tells you, it's not just telling you every time, if you roll equal to or higher than that is a success. They tell you, well, if you roll lower than that is a failure, and it's just phrased differently. So it's less obvious, at least from reading the rulebook, that there is pretty much one basic mechanics applied in many cases. But the game is very simple, very linear, very easy to pick up. The rulebook, I mentioned that small fact, just mainly as nitpicking. Better than that, does a very good job of explaining the game, even if you're not a seasoned war gamer. I think anybody, even like a young player, picking up the game, setting it up, would be able to start playing it in no time. And gameplay is fun. Gameplay is interesting, if very brutal, very violent. It's and there is an advantage in this game. Games are very fast. You, like in Commands and Colors, you can easily play a game in under an hour if you lead a game to its conclusion. Sometimes by turn two, one or two sides may has shed so much blood in the opponent's group that probably the opponent will want to concede, and then you start over and you play another game. Maybe you will want to play a string of battles back to back and see who is the winner in the aggregate. And the game is so fast that it's totally possible to do that in a single evening. So there is that luck factor that a nice roll can inflict huge amount of damage on the opponent, and it's fairly easy to tip the scale and to start the opponent on a slow decline from which it is very hard to come back. In that sense, luck has a factor. Again, the game feels brutal and violent, also you have a small map. Pretty much, if you're playing with one map, you can expect one turn of maneuvering, a second turn of major bashing, of major combat going on, and a third, fourth turn of regrouping, of trying moral checks that don't work, of recovering, stuff like that. With two maps, you have more tactical options. I definitely like the larger scenarios, and if you don't like the scenarios you find here, it's so easy to create your own. I really like the larger scenarios because you have a little more maneuver, more things happen, then gaining position is rewarded. And in that sense, you feel that you have more agency, that the decisions that you make before the major slaughter starts are more meaningful, are more impactful. But overall, if you can get past that, that it's a very violent, brutal, quick game, which for some people will be a plus, then again, you do not have a bad game. With a larger number of units, with larger maps, even that major bloody aspect of the game is not too bad, because again, you can make decisions. There's a point in which sort of lose control and everybody starts firing. It's pure chaos, and when the dust settles, one of the two sides will most likely be past any chance of recovery. But again, pretty much I see how the game is like getting there, positioning your units there. So it's not a bad game. I find it quite enjoyable. Definitely like the card mechanic, and I like the flexibility that you have there. People complain, Commands and Colors, oh my gosh, I do not have the cards to activate my right flank, and I you know, I invested all of my attack on that flank. The game is stupid. I think probably it wasn't a good idea to start with to invest on only one flank. So I don't have any problem with the commands and color system. I think it's just some people do not really understand that the system is meant to encourage cohesion, to encourage good order. But if you are one of those people, then you will not have a problem here, because you will always be able to play a card and you will always be able to activate some of your units. However, the opponent is figuring out ways to activate special effects and you're always using the standard effects, then you are going to be the one that is left on the battlefield. Because the special effects are just so much better than the basic activation. You really need to try to use those as much as possible. I also like the interrupt effects because they add more interaction. When the opponent is taking the turn and pounding your people ruthlessly, at least you may be able to pull a trick out of your sleeve and play an effect. And as you're taking your turn, then there is uncertainty there because the opponent may interrupt you and shoot you with a tank and attack you with mortar and do all sort of effects. So there is that tension element there. Really nice, really fun. So a lot of good things that I have to say about this game. Although I don't think it's for everybody, some seasoned war gamers may want to add to a collection exclusively to show it to young friends, to newbies, to give them a sense of what war games may be like. Seasoned war gamers, however, may not necessarily enjoy putting this game to the table and playing it by themselves or with other seasoned war gamers because it feels very light, because it feels very thin. I hope there will be expansions later so we can have So the game can work in both contexts, per se, as an introduction to war games, and with some more meat added to it as a nice meal for war gamers. So these aspects of the design is light, is quick, is brutal. They're not necessarily pluses or minuses. I think there's a highly subjective element there, and also a contextual element. What I can say that is definitely a weak element of the design is that the components are really not particularly attractive. Those counters are thin. They more or less look the same, which is not that much of a problem, but still they make the board look a little bit drab. And dragging those 10 counters, and then you remove one or two units, and then you move around, then you go back and you see the pile of counters. You do not remember exactly how many there are there. Then you go back to the card. So it's very important that when you remove units, you put the fallen soldiers on the card, so you can see at a glance how many are missing. It just doesn't feel very intuitive. It just feels like having these bunches of people that you slide around. If you're getting a tile that has cover, then you need to pick them all up and dump them on the tile, because the tile is placed on the board. You can just slide them on it, and then they become a bunch, and then again you're sorting them out to figure out exactly if you have 6 or 7. Frankly, for practical reasons, but I see how it would have been less attractive, I think you could just have a larger token that shows a bunch of soldiers, and then you have a die that represents the number of units, and you have the tile indicating the number of soldiers in that unit, and then you have a number indicating the card that with all the specificities of that unit. So it just feels a little impractical, and when you have that impractical element with components that do not look all that good, then I don't know, I just feel the production could have been a little bit better. On the other hand, of course, that helps keeping the price a little lower, which may not be a bad idea when we're talking about an introductory game, which is probably marketed to people that are not stronger gamers yet. They need to be convinced a little bit, and then of course a low price maybe would help them getting in there. They may not want to invest a lot of money in a style of gaming that they do not know much about. In general, Airfix Battles has pluses and minuses, and pretty much I tried to list all that came to mind in my conclusion. I don't have a strong opinion one way or the other. I'm not going to tell you it's a good game or it's a bad game. I think it's an enjoyable game, but the context, the situation in which you play it, I think will have a large role, a large impact on your experience, because an introductory game, and it works well in that context, may not work well in many or in all other contexts. The components are not exciting, but not a deal breaker either. So this is my opinion, a little mix, a little bit of everything, a little bit all over the place, of Airfix Battles. if you're looking for an introductory wargame, you've never tried wargaming, actually this could be a good intro to the hobby. Other than that, I do not know. I'll leave it to you to decide whether or not this is a game for you.